Harper Audio presents The Wrong Way to Save Your Life. Essays by Megan Stielstra, read by Meredith Mitchell and me, Megan Stielstra. For when you are afraid. Stories can conquer fear, you know. They can make the heart bigger. Ben Okri. I am still fighting with my big and small fears. A lifetime or two ago, I lived with my friends Heather and Pete on Armitage Avenue, just west of Western. Our apartment was a unicorn so far as renting in Chicago, an enormous open loft wallpapered with windows and cheap as hell. A hallway snaked back to two smaller rooms, one for me, one for Heather, and behind those, what realtors call the master bedroom, huge, with high ceilings and a skylight. This was Pete's room. He paid double. He had a 9-to-5 job in an art studio with a salary and health insurance, which to me seemed so grown up and impossible, especially for an artist, but he did it. He made art and he made a living. And if he could, I could. At 23, I needed that belief, like food and sex and shelter. When he let me, I'd sit on the floor in his room while he painted, reading aloud from the novels I was studying, and sometimes, if I felt brave, my own nervous starts at stories. I loved being there, part of it. The process, the mess, tubes and brushes and sketches and ashtrays overflowing so he'd ash in empty beer bottles or in mugs filled with days-old coffee or mugs filled with paint water or mugs filled with whiskey or wine. I don't think we owned glassware. I don't think we washed dishes. It made more sense to avoid the stacked piles in the kitchen sink and, instead, grab a mug off Pete's floor and scrub out the moldy coffee cream in the bathtub. He didn't have any furniture, just a mattress on the floor, a cage for his iguana, and canvases. Finished pieces, half-done stuff, still dripping, newly stretched and ready to go. He painted bodies. He painted abstract. He painted me, circus poster style, biting the head off a live chicken after I read him the scene from Geek Love where Aquaboy preaches to the devoted. If they love you, then it must mean you're all right. You poor baby. You just want to feel all right. Read that part again, he said, pointing at me with a paintbrush. He was muscle and sinew, arms full-sleeved with black geometric tattoos. He had a long, pointy goatee a decade before hipsters and, what's it called? Beard art. He wore a belligerent uniform of black jeans and no shirt, never a shirt. He must have owned some, at least for work, or our shitty Chicago winters. Band logo stuff, probably. Slayer, and Black Sabbath, and Behold the Living Corpse. I'm trying to see him, reaching down the line of my life. Memory is portraiture, a still shot instead of a moving picture. He smelled like cigarettes. He built me bookshelves. He'd make both fists into devil horns, yell, "Metal!" and stick his tongue down past his chin. He pointed at me with a paintbrush. Poor baby. You just want to feel all right. For my birthday, he took me to the Art Institute. We were there for hours. He taught me to see. I hope that doesn't sound pretentious. It was actually a gift. We went painting by painting, color, context, scale. I'd be ready to move on, and he'd tell me to wait, look again, look closer. What do you see, he'd say. How was it made? When was it made? What was happening in the world when it was made? How did what was happening influence what was being made? What are you going to make? And when are you going to start? Now, I'd say. Today. The questions we ask about art are equally vital in examining the self. Memory and assumption, love and fear. I'd build on this vocabulary over 2 decades teaching writers and teaching teachers, but I first started thinking about it with Pete in the Art Institute, standing in front of Egon Schiele, Francis Bacon, Toulouse-Lautrec. My favorite is Sky Above Clouds 4, a 24-foot oil painting by Georgia O'Keeffe. It hangs above the back gallery staircase, the ceiling diffused sunlight. It's breathtaking, blue and pink, and a sea of white clouds like cobblestones. I see it like a road, a path. You can walk down the stairs or up into the sky. The truth? I was in love with him. How could I not be, there under the clouds? Nothing happened, of course. He was my roommate. He was my friend. He didn't like me like that. It would have gotten weird. I'd been hurt before. Everything ends badly. Breakups are awful. Divorce requires paperwork. Juliet dies in the end. The iguana smelled. I hated metal. What if he didn't feel the same and I had to stop imagining us together? The video on demand as I fell asleep at night. Uncertainty is better, wrote Chekhov. At least then there's hope. What if we did get together and I hurt him? I didn't want to hurt him. I loved him. So much so that I'd bug him about the cigarettes and he'd tell me to back off and I'd quote statistics about lung-related death and he'd say we could all go at any time, wiped out by a bus, a train, an explosion like lightning, a heart attack, on a mountain, a tumor in the brain, the skin, the breast, by your own hand when it's all too much, or an AR-15 in a school or park or street, so who gives a shit about a cigarette? What's healthy or right or fair? There are so many reasons not to try. They all start with, I'm scared. I started writing about fear in 2008. It seems impossible that this period is already history. The Great Recession, a national and global economic decline beginning with the burst of an $8 trillion housing bubble, .. It sounds like a movie, a novel, something to read about, not live through. My husband and I had just gotten married, just bought a condo, just had a baby, the 1-2-3 punch of the American dream. We were making it, me in education, him in web design. Then, snap your fingers, the market crashed. We couldn't sell. We couldn't rent. We couldn't keep up with the mortgage, which had less to do with the economy and more with me being, quite literally, on the floor. There are so many metaphors about depression in general and postpartum specifically. Mountains climbing over. Waves crashing down, fog moving through, storms up, up, and away. I appreciate the need to find common language, to name the experience and feel less alone in its mess, but I have a hard time seeing the poetry. It sucked. It sucked. It sucked. Our condo was across the street from the Aragon Ballroom, a legendary rock club in Uptown on Chicago's North Side. Bands played every weekend. Fans lined up around the block. You could hear the music through my windows, a weird sort of soundtrack to the most scared I've ever been. Marilyn Manson and My Baby Won't Eat. Smashing Pumpkins and My Baby Won't Sleep. Yeah, Yeah, Yeahs and The Banks Call Every Day. Do you know you're overdue? Do you know the consequences of being overdue? Are you sure? I was scared to leave the house. Scared I would hurt myself. Something is wrong. I can feel it. No, it's not all in my head. At one point, I opened my journal and wrote, I need help. I climbed the stairs to the apartment on Armitage and covered my ears. The music from Pete's room was so loud the apartment vibrated. A car with the bass cranked, a strobe light with sound. In my memory, it was Rammstein, German industrial metal. They play a subgenre of rock called Neue Deutsche Harte, or New German Hardness. Their name translates to ramming stone. That's what my bathroom sounded like. Hardness, ramming, a jackhammer. I went into the bathroom where Heather was getting ready, mascara and lipstick and wild red hair. She worked late-night bar shifts. I worked daytime brunch. We saw each other at 3 a.m. if I was up writing, or 3 p.m. before she ran out the door. We watched Ab Fab and Wuxia films. She took me to buy my first vibrator and my first window air conditioner, necessary appliances for the modern woman. I'm trying to see her, reaching down the line of my life. She smelled like honey. She loaned me dresses. She gave me music, hip-hop, house, and R&B, which in 1998 meant The Miseducation of Lauryn Hill, and in Chicago meant Jesse De La Peña. We'd go dancing at the Subterranean, and I'd study her, hip and swerve and that wild hair. I tried to move like she moved. Hands go here, feet here, ass like this. The same way I learned dialogue from Hurston, pacing from Selby, sentences from Wolfe. Heather wasn't having it. She tried to help, to loosen me up, putting her hands over my eyes and instructing me to feel. "Listen," she said, her lips at my ear. "Being in the music is like being in a book." I've danced with that idea for years, feeling as reading, the body as a text. "What the hell?" I yelled, gesturing at the noise. "I know," Heather yelled. "Something, something, something loud." "What?" I tried talking to him, but what? "He told me," she started, then gave up and made follow me hands. We went down 3 flights of stairs to the driveway and leaned against her minivan, a peach-colored thing she lent to me for teaching gigs. We could hear the music through the windows, but from outside it was muted, pulse instead of punch. A man sold fresh melons from a pickup truck out front. Kids chased an elotes cart down Armitage. Heather lit a cigarette and I reached for it. I didn't smoke, but what else do you do with your hands? She sounded worried as she told me a friend of Pete's had died. She didn't know who. Someone from before us. Someone he loved. "He went into his room and turned on the music," she said, taking back the cigarette. "I tried to talk to him, but..." She stopped, because truly, what do you say? We hold our friends' hands as their hearts break. Lost lovers, lost children, divorce and illness and addiction. There are no perfect words. We can be there. "How can I help?" we say. We say, "I'm sorry." "Is he okay?" I asked. We both looked up, third floor, back of the building. What a stupid fucking question. I don't remember how long it went on. The jackhammer, the locked bedroom door. I want to say weeks, but I'm known to exaggerate, to add the extra 10 feet the hero has to jump. I'd come home from night classes, from student teaching, from waiting tables, from writing in coffee shops, from hanging out at friends' houses so mercifully still and quiet, and every time I climbed the stairs, I felt the floor beneath my feet. "Pete," I'd yell through his door and over the music. "Can I get you anything? And do you want to talk? And the music is really loud." But what I meant was, "How can I help?" "No, and no, and I know," he'd yell back. But what he meant was, "Leave me the hell alone." One night I came home and heard nothing. No jackhammer, no pounding bass. At the time, I was reading the novel So Far From God by Ana Castillo. I was at the part where Faye, the middle sister who'd been screaming for months, stopping only to sleep, then waking up and screaming again, her blood-curdling wail became part of the household's routine so that the animals didn't even jump or howl no more, had suddenly stopped. There was silence. So loud a silence. I heard that book in my own apartment. My life collided with its pages. The shower turned on in the bathroom, and at the end of our snake-like hall, I saw that Pete's door was open. I tiptoed past my room, past Heather's, and into his. 20 years later, and this is what I see. The room wallpapered in dull brown, what looks like grocery bags meticulously cut at the seams, then laid flat and taped together. Look closer, and there's the imprint of folded rectangles and the thick, clear industrial tape. Over that is the paint, dark, dark purple, dark red and blue. thick and globbed, like it was thrown at the wall or sludged on with a knife. It starts at the ceiling and sprays down, running off the paper and onto a tarp over the floorboards, less like you're looking at it and more like you're inside it. I wanted to get out of there. But at the same time, I couldn't look away. A car crash, a bar fight, a shooting.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.